Welcome to the Ben Lowrey Podcast. In this episode, my school friend Mark James is going to tell us about his personal journey with different forms of therapy, and we're particularly going to focus on the use of psychedelics as a therapeutic tool. And Mark participated in a clinical trial in which they were testing the effects of psilocybin, which is the active compound in magic mushrooms. And Mark's going to tell us all about that. If you know anybody else that would make a good podcast guest, then please direct them to benlowrey.com/podcast guest. Enjoy the show. So welcome to the podcast, Mark James. How are you doing today?
Yeah, very good, thank you, Ben. How are you?
I'm good. I'm generally really, really good. Got loads of productive projects going on, and I've got loads of sort of creative sort of output. And this podcast is actually part of the creativity because, you know, you never know where the conversations are going to go. So that's part of the fun, you know.
Oh, sounds good.
And so, yeah, I don't know if you can summarize for our listeners what we're going to be talking about, but I think you were telling me about the multiple modalities or different forms of therapy, why each of them can offer something different. And you were telling me your story, and I don't know where to begin, but where do you want to begin?
Yeah. Maybe if I do I'm going to attempt to do a 30-second introduction to me, but then it might turn into a few minutes.
Yeah,
and
sure.
I'll let you use your editorial discretion to cut that down.
Yeah.
But so what we're going to be talking about today, I definitely don't aspire to be an expert in. It's something that I'm an avid amateur and a passionate and learned amateur, I would say. So I would say treat whatever I say today as just this one man's opinion, and it may be interesting and or useful, it might not be. So when I was about 10 years ago, I was on the dole, and I had quite a lot of freedom in my life, and I felt like I had quite a high hedonic set point. Now, a hedonic set point is like your do you have a natural disposition to be happy or sad? Some people just seem to be happier, and some people tend to be sadder. And if you tend to be happier, then one way of describing that is you have a high hedonic set point. So generally, I was quite happy. Little would get me down. And even though, you know, I was on the dole, I wasn't earning lots of money, blah, 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 blah. And then over the last 10 years, I've been fortunate enough to work all over the world and earn, you know, a reasonable salary, particularly, you know, given that I came from a background where I was homeless and didn't know what I was going to do with my life. So now I'm in a fortunate position where I'm earning decent money and can provide for my family. But with each, over the past like 3 years, I would say, my hedonic set point and my like natural disposition to happiness has just been decreasing and decreasing and decreasing, to the point where about a year ago, I was feeling really, really, really low. So my interest currently is in how can I help as much of humanity as possible to achieve, this a fancy Greek word, eudaimonia, but it kind of means flourishing. So how can I help more people to flourish? Just interrupt if I'm rambling. And then there seems to be like the way in which I think, the greatest opportunity to help humanity flourish seems to be to reduce mental suffering. So over the past couple of years, I've been trying to understand, for me personally, and then for the rest of humanity, what is the best way to mitigate mental suffering? And then I've been trying out each of these different modalities, I guess is one way of describing them. And they kind of fall into these different buckets. And again, this is just my understanding of how you would approach changing someone's mental suffering. I don't know if this is necessarily like what the scientific community would agree is the way to describe these different things. But you've got understanding why you're thinking the things that you're thinking. So that is where psychotherapy comes in, and you try to like uncover from your past why you're thinking what you're thinking.
Example. Give us an example, just so people grasp.
Yeah, so it might be that you I don't know, you've got a bad relationship with your romantic partner and you always tend to behave in a certain way. And one way of understand or one way of approaching that, the way that you're interacting with that person and then the pain that it causes you is to understand that because, okay, so I'll use a real example from my life, from my actual psychotherapy.
Yeah.
It only dawned on me after about 6 months of psychotherapy that because I'd had a relatively disruptive childhood, particularly the formative years, and it tends to be the early years are more influential on your psyche than the later years.
Is that up to age 7? Is it?
And so supposedly the first 4 years are the most critical, and then I guess there's probably a compounding decrease in impact as you get older. I'd been to, it only occurred to me in psychotherapy, and this was about a couple of months ago, that I'd been to something like 5 primary schools. And the consequence of that is every time I went to a new school, there were all these like cohorts of individuals, like these little groups of people that had got together in their little friendship cliques. And I was never able to like infiltrate those friendship cliques. So I always sort of felt like a bit of an outsider. I didn't really feel like I belonged anywhere.
Mm.
And then once I sort of understood that my lack of belonging anywhere, how that manifested itself in how I behave with my work colleagues and how I behave with my wife. Like that was a really useful thing to understand.
Mm.
So that's kind of your psychotherapeutic route, understanding why you're thinking the things that you're thinking. And then another would be to change the relationship with the thoughts that you're having. And there's lots of different ways that you could do that. So mindfulness, meditation, they tend to, I think most seasoned meditation practitioners would suggest that there is no goal. There is nothing that you should be striving for. But it tends to be that you reach a point of awareness where you're, the subjective part of your mind, where you're thinking thoughts, you decouple yourself from that relationship. So you change the relationship to the thoughts that you're having. And then another way of changing your relationship to the thoughts you're having is with cognitive behavioral therapy. And there's lots of different versions of this. But again, it might be whenever I've got a one-to-one with my boss, or whenever I'm going home to see my wife, I tend to feel this way and I tend to behave this way. So you'll develop techniques that help you change the relationship that you've got to those thoughts and feelings. So again, psychotherapy, understanding why you're thinking those thoughts, cognitive behavioral therapy and mindfulness are changing the relationship to the thoughts as they occur.
Mm.
And then you've got the psychopharmacological route, which is, I'm going to ingest some substances or chemicals that will change the chemistry of my brain. And the most common version there, that this is what most people that are clinically depressed will be using, or rather lots of them will be using, are SSRIs, which are selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors. And basically that just means that as your body produces serotonin, which makes you feel happy, your body then reabsorbs it. And then these SSRIs, these drugs that some people that are having depression medication take, they stop your body from reabsorbing the serotonin. So then you have kind of this like a flooding of serotonin. So the third approach then, just to reiterate, is to change the chemicals in your brain to sort of force you to be in a happier mood by overdosing with serotonin. And then the most interesting way to approach, there's a fourth, which is kind of understanding what influences how your body is producing these chemicals physiologically. So knowing that if you haven't had enough sleep, your body behaves in a certain way, or knowing that if you eat certain foods, then that will inhibit your body's ability to deal with stress, and then increases in stress have a negative impact on your serotonin. So the fourth approach is just like understanding kind of like academically what you can do to better prepare your body to deal with the stresses of the world.
Yeah.
And then the fifth, and again, there might be a sixth and a seventh, and maybe the taxonomy of how I'm describing all of this would be different for other people. But the fifth for me is using psychedelics as a way to, it often both increases the serotonin in your body, but I think much more importantly, it allows you to view yourself objectively rather than subjectively. Mm-hmm. And there's lots and lots and lots of literature that describes what is essentially like indescribable, but that there's also a lot of evidence that suggests that using psychedelics within a therapeutic environment, so not going to a party and taking a dose of LSD or MDMA, but actually using it in a therapeutic environment has potentially very, very promising signs of being able to cure lots of people's depression and anxiety and addiction, which might seem a little counterintuitive, that if you're addicted to heroin, you might take a psychedelic drug to cure your addiction. So psychedelics for me, I've tried all of those five different approaches, and psychedelics that definitely seem to offer the most significant opportunity for a bunch of different reasons, but I fear that I've been rambling on there for a few minutes, so I'm going to shut up and let you ask me a follow-up question.
No, that's great. That was a wonderful introduction and summary. And so I've got loads of questions. So while we're on the psychedelics, I mean, what's the best one?
I'll talk about what the scientific literature seems to say. Let me just start by giving a little bit of background to my experience with psychedelics, because that might help listeners understand, you know, where I'm coming from. So I tried mushrooms when I was, I think, 21 or 22 on a trip to Amsterdam, and that was jolly good fun. And that's all I remember of it. I've never bought drugs illicitly. I've never taken anything other than cannabis about 10 times in my life. And every time I really disliked it. So I am not a hardened and ardent drug user. I'm most definitely not. It was when listening to or reading some books from meditation practitioners that talked about some of the positives associated with psychedelic use, in that it can enhance your meditation practice, then I started to do a little bit more reading, and the more I read about the this renaissance of scientific work with psychedelics, so in fact let me give you a very, very brief history of psychedelics. Like LSD, or rather the Western world started to use psychedelics in the sort of 40s and 50s. It was a lot of scientific work went into using psychedelics to help with depression and other illnesses up until the 90s, when I think it was the Reagan administration declared this war on drugs. And then that is like the reason that we have psilocybin, which is the active ingredient in magic mushrooms, and LSD, and all of these drugs that are actually like non-toxic and non-addictive as Schedule One drugs, all stems from the American government's want to dissuade people from taking psychedelics because it seemed to negatively impact their propensity to want to go to war for the American government. Mm-hmm. So, and then what we saw at the very end of the 1990s, and then up until today, is a renaissance of scientific work with psychedelics. And that started at Johns Hopkins University in the States, and it's now there's studies going on all over the world. The way that I sort of approached this was, like all of the scientific literature that I was reading seemed to stack up. I'm reasonably experienced in reading research, so I can kind of tell, I've got a rough idea of like, yeah, this looks like it's empirically valid, this doesn't. So it all seemed to stack up, and I at the time was feeling more and more depressed myself. So I'm like, right, what can I do? Because all of the, like all psychedelics pretty much are still illegal. So how am I going to, I don't want to go and buy something off of the streets because I have no idea what I'm taking. I don't have any relationships to that community. So I wouldn't even know how to find a drug dealer or how to go onto the dark web. So then I stumbled across a scientific trial that was going on at King's College London in January, this January 2019, and was extremely lucky that I was accepted onto the trial. And that was then my first ever kind of proper experience of using psychedelics. I don't know what dose, because it's a placebo double blind with three different doses. So all I know is I've taken some amount of psilocybin in a therapeutic environment, and it has been helpful. So going back to your question of what is the best, there seems to be evidence that substances like ibogaine and iboga, which are not particularly well known, they're mainly used in like African tribes use them ceremonially. They seem to be particularly effective for completely eradicating all of the cravings for heroin addiction or opiate addiction.
Right.
So you could be a long-term heroin user, and supposedly you have like one or two doses of these drugs, and your addiction is not cured, but you no longer have any cravings for those drugs. So it's much easier then for you to sort of wean yourself off the drugs when you're no longer like physically addicted to them. So iboga and ibogaine seem to be good for opiate addiction. LSD, in fact, the drug that has that is closest to being that's closest to having the rubber stamp of approval to be used in a legitimate clinical setting and legalized is MDMA, which is the active ingredient in ecstasy. In fact, when people refer to ecstasy, it tends to be MDMA that they're referring to. So using MDMA in a therapeutic environment for PTSD, so post-traumatic stress disorder, I've probably got that slightly wrong, but that is the... It seems like within the next year or two, so by 2021, say, that will be a legal form of therapy for, and highly, highly effective for treating people with PTSD. So if you're a war veteran and you're coping with some of the trauma of war, or you witness some horrible accident, or you've been sexually assaulted, like whatever the version of PTSD is that you've got, or whatever the cause of that PTSD was for you, MDMA used in a therapeutic environment seems to be incredibly effective at essentially like curing your PTSD. It allows you to view what happened in an objective frame of mind rather than subjective, but I'm sure that there's a better explanation for how it works. So PTSD seems to be very well treated with MDMA. And then most of the work that's going into treating depression, it's psilocybin, which is the active ingredient in magic mushrooms, that is the preferred chemical of choice. And that's mainly due to the fact that a trip on psilocybin, an experience with psilocybin, tends to last around 6 to 8 hours. So within a clinical study, it's fairly easy for the people that are working on that study to do within their workday. So it's a strange situation that's the reason why psilocybin has been chosen, because LSD can last like 16 hours. So if you start your day as a psychiatrist or a therapist working on a study, and that your client doesn't finish his trip for 16 hours, it's just impractical to study. So yeah, so psilocybin for depression.
Right, psilocybin for depression, MDMA for addiction,
PTSD, yeah. But from what I've understood, all of them seem to offer some promise in all, they seem to work similarly well for all things. It's not like you can't treat PTSD with LSD or psilocybin. My hunch would be that they will all offer some probably fairly significant benefit. It just like the scientific literature is still, or the amount of scientific work is still relatively small. So people have been trying to nail, like, can we nail this relationship between MDMA and PTSD? And then probably once that's been legalized, then they might start doing studies into, okay, cool, now can we see if psilocybin works, and can we see if ketamine works? And yeah,
what's the difference between the ones that are synthetically created as opposed to the ones that come directly from the plant? You know, is there a distinction there?
So there seems to be differing opinions here. The sense that I get is those that come from a background that have been using the non-synthesized products, so like ayahuasca or like used in ceremonies. So if you're a shaman, then those people seem to have a predisposition to the form of the drug that they're used to. Whereas the scientific community seems to suggest that there is no difference. So using so DMT, which is the kind of the active ingredient in the ayahuasca brew. I don't know if you've come across ayahuasca before.
Yeah, I've done it.
You've done it, have you?
Yeah, twice.
Ah, wow. Okay, cool. Well, then we've got lots to talk about. So DMT is the thing that gives you the experience, and the ayahuasca that's in the brew, that is just there to allow you to take the DMT in your stomach. So if you just took DMT, orally now, your stomach, the compounds in your stomach would stop the DMT from working. The ayahuasca plant just stops that part of your stomach from disabling the DMT. So, sorry, that was like a little side note. So the ayahuasca doesn't actually do anything psychedelic. It just allows the psychedelic to work. People that have tried synthesized and non-synthesized DMT, and also synthesized and non-synthesized 5-MeO-DMT. So 5-MeO-DMT is the venom from I think it's called the Sonoran Desert Toad. It's a toad that produces this venom that can then be like vaped or smoked. So people that have tried both the actual venom from the toad and then the synthesized version, they seem to suggest that there is negligible, if any, difference between the synthesized version and the naturally occurring one. And then for LSD, there is no naturally occurring LSD. It is very similar to naturally occurring compounds, but it can only be made by humans.
So,
well, I really want to ask you a follow-up question about your ayahuasca experience.
Oh, yeah, go for it.
Yeah, so how did that come about? How did you... tell me the story behind how and why you chose to do ayahuasca twice.
It's about 10 years ago. It's 2009. And I've always sort of had one foot in the kind of hippie alternative communities anyway, because I've always been a bit different. And I had a lot of friends that were living around the Glastonbury, Somerset region. And one thing led to another, and I just got invited. There was no particular reason that I wanted to go. It's just, somebody said, oh, do you fancy doing ayahuasca? And I'd heard about it. I'd read about it. You know, I'd seen documentaries and YouTube clips about it. And my girlfriend at the time invited me, so we went and did it. It was a ceremony setting. It was in a yurt in someone's garden. It was people I knew. So, you know, it was a good experience. No problems. I don't know if the batch was weak or something, because it didn't have a strong effect on me.
Right. And interesting.
It could have been just the batch, because I understand that, you know, people often have a very strong journey with it, you know?
Yeah.
The effect it had on my mind was interesting. I was just telling Graham this the other day. We did a podcast episode, and all I could think about, I was in a very shallow state. Other people were having sort of massive trips and puking up and having all kinds of journeys, but I was in a very mellow and shallow sort of altered state, no visuals, nothing. And all I could think about was I just wanted to go and watch Sky News and see what the stock market was doing.
Wow.
Which is interesting, because you can interpret that sort of however you want, really. I mean, maybe... it was almost like I wasn't really interested in the process or the journey. And I had the sensation of kind of feeling a bit bored and thinking, oh, fuck this. I want to go and see what's going on the news. You know, I'm interested in politics and economics and stuff. And so, I mean, maybe that's the lesson I got from it. Like, that's my true nature. That's what interests me. Maybe that's what it was showing me. Or maybe it was a weak batch. And I don't know. You can interpret it very in different ways, you know?
So, I don't know whether this was true for your situation, but you can definitely it seems like there's evidence that you no matter how large, well, I might take that back, actually, even if you're taking a large dose of a well-known psychoactive substance, where you know that there is no question of whether the batch was weak or not. Like, if you're taking LSD, if you're not able to commit to the experience, you can kind of like turn it off. So I've heard of people that, like, they're with a group of friends, they've all taken LSD, it's all the same batch, but they're nervous about something because one of their friends is having a bad trip or something, and they seem to be able to like just turn the experience off, or it seems to just have like close to no effects whatsoever.
Right.
So I'm wondering if there was something that was stopping you from going into the experience, and maybe some of your friends were, or you were around people that you weren't so sure about, or it was an unfamiliar environment, or I don't know, there could be a bunch of different things. And maybe it literally had no effects on you whatsoever. And there's nothing to be learned about the fact that you wanted to go and watch the stock market at all, because the ayahuasca wasn't doing anything. But I don't know. So that sort of just leads me on to something that is worth mentioning, like, for people that are interested in taking psychedelics. The most important component, if you're taking psychedelics because you want it to help you with something, so you're using it therapeutically, more important than the compound that you're taking is the set and setting. So this is a phrase that you'll hear again and again and again within the psychedelic community. So the set is the mindset that you come to the experience with. So what are my expectations? What am I hoping to get out of this? What is all of the research that I've been reading about this? How is that informing how my experience is going to go? And then the setting is, am I with people that I trust, ideally love, I feel safe with? Is the environment like clinical? Or am I if I'm at a party when there's lots of people surrounding me and lots of chaos? And so the set and setting has a massively, massively influential impact on the experience, more so than the compound itself, most people would say. So it may be, like, I would just use that as a guide for anyone thinking of doing this. Please, please, please look into set and setting. But that could be the reason why your ayahuasca experience didn't go according to plan. But you said you had two experiences, right? So what happened on the other?
The second one was not long after, and I can't remember how long after. It might have been within 6 months or within a year.
Right.
I can't remember. I got a feeling it was the same batch because it had been brought over from South America by, you know, particular individuals, and they were sort of doing a bit of a tour, and it was a sort of similar group of people. So I don't remember, but I think it was the same batch. A little bit deeper. I had sort of more visuals. I think I went a bit deeper. You know, nothing strong, nothing, no real strong, you know, still a pretty gentle ride. Nothing really stood out about it. But, you know, that was a long time ago. You know, a lot's happened since then. 10 years has passed. You know, I'm a different person. I'd be up for doing it again. I'm not attached to any story. Like, I don't have any story that I'm kind of resistant to the compound or anything like that. It's not that. It genuinely was that was my particular experience of those occasions. So I'd be up for trying again, you know?
Yeah, interesting. So if you were wanting to do it again and you wanted to approach it like scientifically, as in you wanted to come away from the experience knowing that, oh yeah, I definitely had a a decent batch, for example, there's a few different ways that you could approach that. If you don't have a good network of drug dealers that you could trust, I guess. So find a clinical trial that you could get onto, and they're quite rare, and they tend to select maybe like somewhere between 1% and 10% of the applicants. But if you're lucky enough, then find a clinical trial, and I can probably send you a link later that you could then put on the notes of the podcast for like how you go about finding clinical trials.
Cool.
And then there's about 10 or 15 organizations that run legal experiences for therapy. I've just signed up for one a couple of weeks ago. In fact, the day that I saw you last, they will give you a legal and known dose of typically psilocybin, and then that will be accompanied with 2, 3, 4, 5 days of experience, including. So nothing in the UK because it's not legal. So they are all in either Jamaica or the Netherlands. So obviously I'm going to the Netherlands given that I'm in the UK. There's probably others that I'm not aware of, but I know of about 10 or so in the Netherlands, different organizations that do this, and then a few in Jamaica. Now they're quite costly. So I think to do an experience with one of these organizations, you're looking at probably £600 to £1,500, depending on a bunch of different things. So they're not cheap, but if you're suffering and you can afford it, and I fit into both of those categories, then it might be worth, something to be explored.
Yeah. Absolutely, yeah, I would consider that. I mean, maybe not this week, but it's something I would think about and research and potentially do.
Another way of buying LSD testing kits that will tell you whether what you've bought as LSD, whether that's safe or not, and whether it is LSD, buying those testing kits is legal. So again, I can send you a link afterwards. So if you wanted to try LSD and you were worried about, you wanted to make it as scientific as possible, but you couldn't afford to go on one of these experience retreats, you could try and acquire some LSD illegally. I'm not suggesting that you do that, but I'm just saying that is an option. And then use one of these testing kits to check whether it's legit or not. And then the most important thing you want to do then is, like I say, try and optimize the set and setting. So take it with, if you know people that are experienced drug takers and you trust them, then take it with them in an environment that you feel comfortable in. But really that set and setting thing is seems to be really, really, really crucial.
So you've signed up to this thing, and it's for it's a psilocybin one, is it?
That's right. Yeah. So they actually use organic truffles rather than, when I did the clinical study, it was with synthetically produced psilocybin at massive expense because it was a scientific trial that they can't. They have to know that you're getting exactly the same dosage as everybody else. So when I do this experience with this organization, they're a very well-known organization. They've done hundreds and hundreds, if not thousands of these, and they've always used the same supplier to use the truffles. So I've got reasonable confidence that I'm going to get approximately the dose that I think I'm going to get.
And what's their name?
They're called the Psychedelic Society. There are branches of the Psychedelic Society all over the world. I know that in the UK they've got quite a strong strongholding, or whatever the expression is, in London and Bristol, and they're looking, I think, to start something down in Cornwall, I think, or Devon. And they run their retreats in the Netherlands, but it's the UK branch of the Psychedelic Society that runs them.
I see.
And I'm actually working with the Psychedelic Society on like a little side project at the moment. So that's sort of how I came across it. I'm trying to, I want more of my life to be spent on this subject, like scientific psychedelic use. So I've been trying to reach out to different organizations to figure out how can someone with the skills that I've got help this movement? So I'm doing it with the Psychedelic Society in October. So maybe you and I can have a catch-up call in a couple of months, and I'll let you know what effect, if any, it had on me.
Yeah, absolutely. I want to hear more about that. But also, I was curious, what other experiences, psychedelic things, do you plan on doing in the future? Like, are you going to try them all?
I don't know. I definitely want to ease myself in. I want to start in as empirically as possible, so which I was lucky enough to do with this clinical study, and then the next level, kind of towards using it recreationally whenever I want, seems to be doing it with a group of individuals or with an organisation that does this regularly. And I've heard very, very, very powerful things can come from 5-MeO-DMT, which is this. It's the venom from the Sonoran desert toad.
I've mainly heard about that from listening to Mike Tyson, because he does it quite regularly by the same.
Oh, really? Does he? Yeah. I didn't know that. Ah, okay. Interesting. So I would just preface this with, if you want to know any more about psychedelics from someone more educated and better informed than me, I would always recommend starting with a book called The Psychedelic, How to Change Your Mind by Michael Pollan, who's a New York Times journalist. It's beautifully written. It talks you through the history of psychedelics, what the current scientific community is doing, and then his own experiences with psilocybin, I think mescaline, LSD, and 5-MeO-DMT. My goal is to suffer less mentally. If this one experience with psilocybin does that, then great. And then maybe I'll use the occasional bit of psilocybin in the future. I've heard mixed things about microdosing with LSD, but that could be something useful for me in the future. I'm open-minded. I'm open to trying anything, I think. But I've heard a few, not horror stories, but words of, or things that make me slightly cautious about trying 5-MeO-DMT, in that it can be more powerful than you can kind of comprehend, and then has lasting negative effects. But that could be that those people that I've heard that from didn't have the right set and setting, and then also didn't have any form of integration afterwards. So integration is the process of you essentially trying to make sense of what happened with the psychedelic experience. And that integration it seems to be much better when you're doing it in a therapeutic environment with someone that understands how to do psychedelic integration. Mm-hmm. So that might be a therapist that you would then speak to once a week, month, every 6 months or something. So it could be, that these people that have had these long-term negative effects using 5-MeO-DMT just didn't have the right integration or set and setting. Mm. How about you? What would you be, what would your shopping list be if you were to start experimenting with these things? How would you approach it, and what would you do next?
Well, even though I've done ayahuasca, I don't consider myself to have, I haven't done anything else, so I feel like I would need to start gently. And I thought perhaps mushrooms might be a good place to start. Do you think?
Yeah, definitely. There seems to be some literature suggesting that starting at a lower dose and working your way up to a higher dose has better effect than going in at a medium or high dose. Mm. So I definitely recommend, as you suggested, starting with something lower. Mushrooms or psilocybin, that seems to be a good entry point, particularly given that in the Netherlands it's legal. So you could even arrange your own, experience retreat, where you went over there and bought some stuff legally. I would definitely recommend magic mushrooms or psilocybin seems to be a good entry point at a reasonably low dose.
Yeah, I suppose sort of start at mushrooms and then work up to the toad. Is that the way it goes? Or
I don't know that it's useful to have that plan in mind, I'm going to start here, work up to this, and then try this, and then try this, and then try this. For me personally, I'm just going to take each, I know what the next step is. Yeah. I don't need to know about what comes after that until I need to think about what comes after that.
Yeah.
If I feel psychologically stable enough to start trying LSD and then the toad, then maybe. But I intentionally don't have a plan of like, how do I get to the toad? I want to get to the toad as quickly as possible.
Yeah.
That seems to be probably a suboptimal way of approaching things.
Yeah, I'm with you. I think I say it kind of tongue in cheek, but I understand what you mean. why have I never heard the phrase hedonic state? As somebody who's sort of just broadly interested in personal development and popular psychology, why have I never encountered that
word? I think the only person that can answer that is you. But
what school of thought does it come from?
So the way that I discovered psychedelics was via meditation. And the reason that I got into meditation was because about 2 or 3 years ago, I got into philosophy. So I'm relatively ill-educated, left school with no qualifications, never thought about reading any like philosophical literature, but then found myself stumbling into psychology and philosophy a couple of years ago. And one of the branches of like ancient Greek philosophy is hedonism, which most people will think of today as people that are in pursuit of ultimate pleasure. So that's like guys that are interested in, or girls that are interested in, yachts and Ferraris and having loads of money and dining at the finest restaurants in the world. And that's a pursuit of hedonism. There's lots of branches, or there are some branches of hedonism that also exist for the pursuit of pleasure, but those pleasures are less, I'm going to use the word vacuous, but like there's, I'm going to try and remember what it's called now. There's a branch of hedonism that says that the ultimate pleasures are like a nice piece of bread or a bit of cheese and company with your friends and having long and interesting conversations. But then those are the things to be pursued. And so you're still trying to pursue pleasure rather than just stoicism, which would be sort of the mitigation of suffering. So this branch of philosophy is part of hedonism in that, no, you're not trying to mitigate suffering, you're trying to maximally pursue pleasure, but the pleasure that you're seeking is just a much more, I guess, like real and honest and humble version of pleasure. So the hedonic set point comes from hedonism, which is the pursuit of pleasure. And I don't know where the phrase hedonic set point originated, but I've read a fair amount, or a reasonable amount, of positive psychology literature, which gets mixed reports within the psychological community. That's sort of where I heard about it. And it is basically like, where do you sit within the spectrum of all humans in terms of your natural disposition to be happy or sad, I guess.
At this point in your journey, what is it that makes you happy? How would you define happiness? What's the best plan for being happy?
So definitely money that is not correlated to happiness past a certain point. I think at the moment it's around $70,000. Once you get past that, then there is very little incremental happiness gained from each additional dollar that you spend. For me, freedom seems to be really important in terms of my happiness. So having a life where I can make the choices that I want to make. But the things that seem to make me genuinely the happiest, and they sound a bit like saccharine and boring, but are like going for a nice walk with my daughter. Or like yesterday, I took my four-year-old up to the local park here to do some skateboarding. Just spending time in the company with the, in fact, you know what, most scientific literature would seem to suggest that the most important thing for your happiness is spending time with the people that you love. And that seems to be the most impactful thing that you can do if you want to be happier, is to have a group of people whom you love and trust and want to spend time with, and then spending time with them. Which is like a boring but truthful answer.
Yeah.
And I don't have a large cohort of friends that I kind of spend a lot of time with, because I've lived, you know, in different cities and countries. They all tend to be a bit dispersed. So that's something that I need to cultivate if I want to be happier, I think. Like, one way to do that is to mitigate the amount of suffering that I, like mental suffering that I have. And another is like cultivating more and deeper friendships.
So mitigating suffering as opposed to cultivating happiness, there's a distinction there.
Yeah, it's not a linear scale. It's not like that they're two completely separate enterprises. So it's not like like I said, it's not a that the same activities that you do to mitigate suffering are not necessarily are not the same activities that you would do to increase happiness.
Right. So it's like toxins and nutrients, like reducing your intake of toxins is not the same as increasing your intake of nutrients.
There you go. Yeah. That's a really good analogy. Thank you. For me, it feels like I don't want to worry about the nutrients that I'm consuming until I've sufficiently mitigated the toxins that I'm intaking. So most of my focus is on mitigating my own suffering rather than pursuing more pleasures. But I hope that it will get to a point where there's a satisfactory amount of mental suffering in my life. I'm not looking to completely eradicate it. Like, that one of the nice things about one of the words I used earlier, eudaimonia, is it's not a life devoid of suffering. Like, you will have suffering in your life. People will die and you will get ill and all of these things will happen, and that's totally fine. But you're just trying to make the most of your life. So I'm not looking to mitigate or to eradicate mental suffering, but I definitely want a lot less of it than I currently have. Once I've got to a position that I think is satisfactory, I have a satisfactory amount of suffering in my life. Like, if bad things happen, I'll still get sad. That's okay. And then I'll start to focus a little more on, right, now how can I increase the number of pleasurable hedonic things within my life?
Yeah. Has everyone got, like, why is it that some people are more prone to suffering than others? Is that just good luck, bad luck, genetic, environmental, or just a mixture of it all? Like, I don't want to put you on the spot to sort of talk about things that are too personal, but, you know, why are you suffering in the first place?
Yeah, it's really weird. I don't think I'm not sure that it's entirely genetic, because for me, like, I've changed. So it's not like I was born with one disposition and that stayed with me forever. Like I say, 10 years ago, I was on the dole, and I seem, my memory, which could definitely be false, like maybe I was really, really unhappy, but I seem to remember being a very happy chap. Little would worry me. Yeah, I didn't have like any money really, but I didn't care that much. And now, 10 years hence, I suffer like really from anxiety, particularly work-related. And I'm not sure. I suspect that there have been things that have happened in my life over the course of those 10 years that have caused me to become more and more anxious about certain things.
Why does work cause you anxiety? Is it related to sort of money and income and supporting your family?
No. Or is it Not really. I'm not super, because I can remember being like on the dole, the dole is like for people outside of the UK, like income support, I guess. So if you don't work, the government gives you money to just look for a job. Because I can remember what life was like that, I'm not afraid of my daughter having to experience that, and I don't think my wife would be particularly pleased, but I don't think that the reason that I get so much anxiety with work is, I think it's mainly, and I don't know how constructive this will be to the conversation, but I'm worried that I'm just doing a shit job and that nobody likes me. And I think this stems back to what I was describing in my psychotherapy, where I went to lots and lots of primary schools and never really developed a cohort of friends. And I don't really have any like close friendships that I see regularly in my life right now. The people that I see most regularly are people at work. And I just constantly feel like I'm disliked and I'm doing a crap job. And I try really hard for that not to be the case. Mm-hmm. And perhaps that is not the case. Perhaps people are ambivalent to my existence, but they don't dislike me. I don't know. But whatever the reality is, whether people like me and are happy that I'm there and I think that I'm doing a good job or not, the reality, whatever the reality is, I still have huge amounts of anxiety that none of those things are true and that people broadly wish I didn't exist. So yeah, I used to like really like myself, but back in when I was on the dole, like I used to have a high opinion of Mark, like, oh yeah, you're a good, kind person. Now I think I've got quite a low opinion of myself, and I'm not sure how that's come about. But yeah. I'm really hopeful that this experience with psilocybin in October is going to go some ways to uncovering what the fuck is going on in my head. I don't know if we're allowed to be explicit.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Yeah, yeah, I see. So, yeah, I had a kind of journey that was similar, but I had a higher opinion of myself when I was younger. And then I went through this rough patch where I split up with my girlfriend, and then every girl I tried to ask out wasn't interested in me. Like, I went through this period of like several years where I just couldn't get a girlfriend. I just didn't get anywhere. I was just getting rejected over and over again, left, right, and center. And over a period of several years, that it just slowly ground me down and down and down and down. You know, each one's like a punch to the gut, uppercut to the jaw, you know, hook to the side of the head, you know, just getting beaten, you know. And I've largely come out of that now. You know, I've gone through that process and kind of come out the other side. And but yeah, you know, it's weird how, you know, when I was at school or in my early 20s, sort of up to and all the way up to that point, I had a really sort of high self-esteem. And then I received a sledgehammer to my self-esteem. And then I've come back up again. So
how did you come back out of it?
Well, 18 months of therapy.
Right. Was that CBT, psychotherapy?
Psychotherapy.
Right, okay.
Yeah. Besides that, nothing in particular, just building on small successes and incrementally, slowly rebuilding, you know, just small successes. You feel a little bit better about yourself, more success, you know, just building momentum back up just manually. So just manual. Yeah, but it took, you know, there's a process of several years of rebuilding, you know.
And is there a part of you that is like, do you genuinely feel that that part of your life is behind you now? Like you say that you come out of it. Are you saying that because it's the right thing to say, or it's the thing that you want to hear yourself saying? Or do you genuinely feel like, no, I'm definitely out of this?
Yeah, I genuinely, on the most part, I am. There's still echoes. It's got better and better. I'm pretty much there now. But if I go back 12 months or 18 months, no, I wasn't. Yeah, I don't think there's any way of rushing it. It seems to be a slow process of gradual improvement, you know?
So that's like now looping back into psychedelics. A phrase that I've heard quite a few times is that one therapeutic psilocybin experience is the equivalent of 20 years of therapy. How true that is, I don't know. I'll hopefully have a better idea in a few months' time. But I also felt when I was going through therapy that, oh, this is going to be a slow burn. I'm not going to get any, like, she's not going to tell me anything today that is going to completely transform my psychological suffering. I'm just going to have to stick with this for a few years, as you did. But then, yes, psychedelics might not be like that. It might be that something profound can happen within a day or two. Might be worth investigating. Nice to hear that you've come out of the other side though, and you genuinely seem to be happier. Was there anything in particular within your therapy that you don't have to talk about what that thing was, but were there any like looking back at that 18 months of therapy, were there any like big realizations, or was it, can you pinpoint what it was that helped or that was causing you to suffer?
It's hard to put my finger on, but I'll try and boil it down. It's like basically realizing that certain things are not your fault. I think I'd taken certain things entirely personally as a reflection on my identity and self-worth, and the process of realizing that that's not the case, that there's a mixture of reasons of why things happen, you know, there's all kinds of reasons, and it's not just because of my worth or lack of self-worth, you know, realizing that there was all other factors, and also the kind of people, the kind of girls I was going for, there was a problem there. There was like a pattern of me sort of kind of going for people that sort of weren't interested or weren't available, and I was getting over emotionally invested like way too quickly, and you know, when it wasn't reciprocated. So I had to deconstruct a lot of patterns. I had to stop a lot of my behavioral patterns. So yeah, there's nothing in particular, I don't think. It was just a long process of all those little realizations.
Interesting. So what's the next step for you then, and when? Do you have a plan or?
Well, I'm on a really good track and I've got good momentum now. You know, things are good. I've got loads of good projects on the go that I enjoy. I've got, you know, loads of things I enjoy, loads of business ventures. Much better. Oh, yeah, I'll tell you a big part of it. It was like the quality of my friends now is are much more aligned to who I am. And what that means is I can be myself around them. Excuse me. I was really immersed in a community. Because I'd spent a lot of time doing circus skills and acrobatics and yoga and stuff. And whilst there is a lot of positive things about that, that I found very appealing, also those communities are very different to how I am. I'm kind of ambitious, kind of capitalist kind of person, sort of success orientated, you know, kind of thing. And those communities are sort of, you know, very far left leaning, anti-capitalist, and sort of that have got a completely different set of values to me. And what that really meant for my psychology is I was not able to really be myself around. And that wears you down, doesn't it? And so now, rather than trying to connect with everyone, I'm not trying to connect with everyone. I just sort of keep a smaller circle of higher quality friends that are more, you know, more like-minded to me, and I'm much happier like that.
So what you asked me this question earlier, well, like, what is happiness, or how do you become happy? What would your answer to that question be?
Well, I agree with the friendships and companionship, like you were saying about earlier, you know, being around people you love, of course, you know, that sort of goes without saying it. But also, maybe we don't see eye to eye, is I've always been highly, how am I going to say it? I get a thrill, like succeeding, doing a project, and the money and the success. And I know you said sort of money doesn't correlate to happiness, but there's something about the process of the challenge, that overcoming the challenge of making something happen in a business project, that is satisfying and fulfilling. And I don't think it ends anywhere. It's a continual process of more growth, challenge, overcoming, striving, creating, you know, I think that never ends. So I don't think it's a question of when I reach X amount, then I'll be happy. It's more a process of constant creative challenge is fulfilling.
Yeah, but could it not be that it doesn't need to be financial, the outcome. It's just taking on something difficult and essentially like mastery is typically something that's important within your working life, like the feeling that you're mastering something. So it could be that the thing that is gratifying and that you're drawn towards doesn't necessarily have to be correlated to financial outcome. It could be that you've taken on something really difficult and then succeeded, and success in that project happened to be like the financial outcome, but having that money isn't the thing that is making you happy. It's the fact that you were able to accomplish a very challenging and difficult goal, and it just so happened that money was the outcome of that.
I don't know.
Or maybe not.
I don't know. I hear what you're saying, but I think financial achievement is satisfying as well, because it buys stuff that, you know. You see what I mean? I like the pursuit of money.
Interesting. I'd love to dig deeper into what it is that you like about that, about money. Why do you like having money?
Because it buys stuff.
Why do you want to buy stuff?
Well, for
once you've reached a point where, okay, cool, I've got a roof over my head, I can afford to buy food, and I'm comfortable, don't need to worry about money anymore. Why is it nice to buy stuff?
Well, it just never ends. Then you can help other people. Then, you know, you can.
But the helping other people, that is the. Then I'm challenging you, not because I necessarily disagree. I'm just trying to play devil's advocate, I guess. But like, helping other people, that is rewarding in and of itself. Interesting. I'm trying to think of like why having more money might not necessarily yield happiness. I guess for most people, they don't spend it on things that are genuinely gratifying. They're on this hedonic treadmill. There's another use of the word hedonism. They're on the hedonic treadmill, and they'll never earn enough to make them happy. They'll be happy the day that that money lands in their bank account or they get the promotion, but then extremely quickly that becomes their normative amount of money, and it's no longer pleasurable to be earning $407,000. They want to earn $450,000.
Yeah.
But the buying stuff for yours, I guess if you're buying things for other people, maybe that's, in my head, that's different to buying things for yourself.
No, see, there's a distinction there. I'm not interested in buying stuff. I'm interested in making money. There's a distinction.
Right.
I don't want toys.
I said, why do you want to earn money? You said, well, because it enables you to buy stuff.
Well, yeah, there's that as well. But no, the challenge of pursuing it and making it is thrilling. Like, I'm not into stuff. I'm not into toys and things like that. I have no fantasies of buying a bow or buying a particular car. But the process of like building business, making money, that I find sort of thrilling.
Interesting. Yeah. That makes sense. It feels to me like you want to, like, you gain pleasure and gratification from achieving difficult things, and the measure, the yardstick that you're using for whether something is difficult or not is, have I made lots of money?
That makes sense.
So yeah. I'm not sure that we're necessarily disagreeing. I think that we're just what money represents in each of our arguments is maybe slightly different.
Yes, I agree. Because there is a lot of it's not as simple as just saying sort of money won't make you happy. That's a sort of oversimplified sort of view of it, isn't it? There's many sort of factors within the conversation in there of what it is about it that, you know.
What we can say fairly empirically, though, is the amount of money that you have does not seem to correlate to happiness over and above a threshold. So not you, Ben, or me, Mark, but people generally, and because there's enough studies that have been done that prove this, that shows that, yeah, that the amount of money that you have or that you earn is not correlated to your happiness. There are just as many fucking miserable multimillionaires and billionaires as there are happy people living on the breadline.
Not on the breadline,
but yeah.
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 Yeah, I accept that. It doesn't guarantee happiness. Yeah. It's in stuff.
we sort of rambled away from, if I was to like summarize what was this podcast about, or how to write a title for it, I'd be thinking, yeah, I'm not really sure. We've sort of gone all over the place.
So,
life and the pursuit of happiness, maybe.
Who are you listening
to? Philosophy in a nutshell.
Who am I listening to? Yeah.
So the person that I am the biggest fanboy of and have been listening to for the longest time is Sam Harris. I don't know if you listen or read Sam Harris.
A little bit, but not a great deal.
So I think he's just all kinds of wonderful. Mm. I listen to lots of like psychedelic research, scientific papers. I used to, like, all of my reading used to be about becoming better at my job. But over the last, I don't know, like 3 to 5 years, I sort of feel like I'm good enough. I don't want to become any better, really. I think there's much more opportunity to be gained from reading works of philosophy. Or I read no fiction. I'm a terrible fiction reader, other than to my daughter at bedtime. Mm. I listen to, maybe I get through a book a week, and maybe like 2 or 3 hours of podcasts a day.
A book a week, so
I listen, typically listen to audiobooks on like 2 or 3x speed, so I'll get through like a 7 to 11 hour book in a week.
Plus
2 or 3 hours of podcasts a day, again listening at like double speed. It depends on the density of the information. Like if a book is really complicated, then I won't be able to listen at 2 or 3x. But I'm quite ravenous. When I was younger, like I never really read. I had no interest in books. So it's become like I've come to books only in the last like 5 years, really. And because I'm a really, really slow reader of like physical books, the advent of Audible has been transformative in terms of my personal growth, and it's been amazing. So yeah, I would like, definitely Sam Harris is up there, and then there's like some stuff I listen to for pleasure as well. Like I like the Adam Buxton podcast, Richard Herring podcast. Yeah, they just sort of they made me feel happy just hearing their silly voices. Mm. I listen to like lots and lots of like business management, the Andreessen Horowitz podcast, and the Y Combinator stuff, loads of psychedelic podcasts and books. Oh. How about you? What does Ben listen to?
Well, I like Jordan Peterson. I listen to him.
Oh, interesting. Why do you like Jordan Peterson?
Because I think the stuff he says about psychology sounds correct. It makes sense. In fact, I think he's had a big positive impact on me.
How has that impact manifested? What has changed about you since reading or listening to Jordan Peterson?
I think accepting it, and you talked about it earlier, sort of accepting that struggle and suffering is sort of part of life and there's no way avoiding it. That's a big part of it. Are you familiar?
So I've heard him interviewed on a bunch of different podcasts, and then I started to read his, is it 12
Rules for Life?
12 Rules for Life, yeah. And it was just, I don't know, that I really struggle with organized religion, and there was just a lot of like religious subtext that I struggled to get past. And then some of the ideas just felt a little, I'm not sure. Maybe I should reread it. Like, it seems to really resonate with young white men. And I am I'm maybe getting off of middle age now, but I think I am still a young white man. Feel like I'm in the target market for that book. I should like it, but I just haven't been it. Do you know what? I think there's probably a bit of confirmation bias because I'm such a big Sam Harris fanboy, and Sam has some thing he like sort of kind of disagrees with some of what Jordan Peterson thinks. I think I've just stupidly bought into that opinion. Well, if Sam disagrees, then I must disagree. Mm. And I need to go back and view it again, maybe with a little more open-mindedness.
Mm.
But that's interesting to hear that you like him.
Yeah.
Who else?
I listen to Stefan Molyneux.
Oh, I've heard the name. Who is he?
He's a podcaster. You probably recognize his face. He does a lot of commentary on politics and current affairs, but my favorite stuff of his is actually when he does a call-in show and he's talking about people's childhood and relationship and sort of doing agony aunt kind of therapy kind of conversations.
Ah, interesting.
They're my favorite, but he's good. These are
I
all.
don't listen to or I the news and current affairs is almost completely eradicated from my life.
Right.
I read an article by Aaron Waltz, I think his name was. He was a hacker that committed suicide some time ago, and he wrote a blog post on how he completely eradicated news from his life. And I'm fairly sure that I'm less unhappy.
Right.
Because I don't watch any news, never buy a newspaper, and the consequence is I'm fairly ignorant to current affairs, but I'm kind of okay with that. It
Yeah.
interested me when you said earlier that you, when you were doing the ayahuasca experience, you wanted to see what the stock market and like to go onto Sky News, and I never would have realised that you, Ben, were an avid news and current affairs digester.
Yeah, I don't know if this is a great thing either. Definitely in moderation is a good idea, and I wonder if I could live without it. I'm not sure. There's the part of me that's hooked into it and is entertained by it, quite frankly, I mean, I follow it out of interest, and so I got mixed feelings about it. It's I've definitely gone through phases where I've got lost, gone down the rabbit hole of spending too much time watching conspiracy theories about the world, and I think I found a balance now between sort of living life and watching stuff that's nothing to do with my day-to-day life. So I'm not sure. I think there is a balance that works, but I do question the negativity that it brings. I'm not sure about that.
Just like your juice fast that you did recently, maybe you could have a current affairs fast for a couple of weeks and just see how you feel at the end of it.
Yeah, I could do. I could do. Yeah, I'm not
It
sure. I'll have
doesn't
to
sound
think.
like you're that motivated to do it,
Yeah,
so
I'm
I
not
won't
sure.
push
Yeah, I don't know. There's part of me
that
that likes to know, but yeah, there could be something in that. I'm undecided.
one.
And also, I listen to Joe Rogan, which has got a lot of variety. And by the way, I love listening to Mike Tyson because he's so kind of childlike and open and kind of pure. He's one of those people who just says whatever he's thinking and has no filter. And in a way, because he kind of already proved how tough he is and how manly he is, he's got this thing about him that he's got nothing to prove. So there's a kind of simpleness to him. And also, he's been through a lot of trauma and suffering and grief and loss and all that kind of thing. So I find him really fascinating.
So, if I wanted to listen to one Mike Tyson podcast, which one would you recommend?
Oh, I'll have to think about that. There was a documentary about 10 years ago that was good.
Ah, okay.
And he's very emotionally lucid as well. He'll get emotional from one sentence to the next. He'll start crying, and then like
Wow.
in every interview he gets emotional. So he's quite fascinating. He's sort of And th there's a kind of what I get from it. There's a kind of permission that comes from it. It's like just because you're emotional, just because you've suffered or stuff that's bothering you, doesn't mean you're not a man. Doesn't mean you're not tough. Doesn't mean those kind of things. That's what he kind of resembles to me,
Interesting. Oh, that's nice.
Yeah.
I've never have, I know very little of Mike Tyson, so yeah, I'm intrigued now to go and find out more.
Yeah. So there's that. And what else do I listen? Well, on a different tact, Abraham, which is more of a spiritual thing. You familiar?
No, I'm guessing it stems from the Abrahamic religions.
Actually, no. Abraham Hicks is a woman who claims to channel this spirit called Abraham, right?
Okay,
Now,
it sounds pretty wacky.
yeah, it is pretty wacky. And I think the best way of I just ignore that. And just the words and the advice that she comes out with, I find very sort of soothing and useful and positive. And I wouldn't say, I don't think you can just live your life by that alone, but I think it's very helpful. If you're feeling stressed or feeling negative, then Abraham brings a kind of soothing reassurance and positivity, which has been really useful.
Okay, cool.
Yeah,
I think I'll dip into Mike Tyson before I dip into people channeling spirits. Maybe. But one thing that, like, 2 years ago, I was about as devout an atheist as you would find.
Yeah.
And I think that's one of the reasons I sort of fell in love with Sam Harris. But following like a meditation practice and doing this psilocybin experience, I'm definitely much more open-minded to... Yeah, I don't know what the true nature of existence is, but I feel a little less closed-minded about different ideas behind spirituality. So that's been quite a useful thing, I guess, to be more open-minded about something.
Yeah, because being... Like, there's two ends of the spectrum, isn't there? You can be so open-minded that you're just gullible and naive and you believe everything and you've got very little rationality or objectivity. But then at the other end of the spectrum, you can be so skeptical that you believe that only the stuff that you understand exists and nothing outside of it does, you know. And there's, I think it's good to just, you know, be somewhere a bit in the middle, isn't it? Sort of open-minded and rationally skeptical as well.
I think... The two aren't mutually exclusive in terms of open-minded and rationally skeptical. I think like having views that you're not prepared to change feels like the opposite of open-minded.
Right.
And I, again, as you suggested, there are some things for which it is probably not worth spending a lot of, like there are some opinions that you hold that it's probably okay that you never entertain whether you're wrong about those opinions.
Yeah.
But then most things in life I'd much rather be on the open-minded end of the spectrum than on the fixed closed-minded end of the spectrum. I'd rather always be open to being proven wrong and as a consequence spend an awful lot of like cognitive energy constantly reevaluating things than... Yeah, I think that, like, for me, that's a happy compromise.
Yeah.
I'd rather be right than wrong but certain. Maybe a better way of explaining it is I'd rather be right but confused than certain and wrong.
Yeah, I'm with you. Yeah, I'm the same. By the way, how has fatherhood changed you?
Oh man, we're gonna need another hour or two. It's definitely made me so. When my daughter was first born, I was the number one person in my life for the first probably couple of years, which I think is relatively unusual. Well, I don't know. The story that you hear is, as a father, once you hold your child in your arms for the first time, then your world is completely changed forever, blah, 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 blah. I didn't have that at all. Like, for the first year, my daughter was largely a massive inconvenience and the thing that jeopardized my own self-actualization. And then it's only in the last, like, few years that I've realized kind of how wrong that... Not wrong, because there's no right or wrong, but it's definitely changed for me in that I now definitely care much more about my daughter's happiness than I do my own. Although that it's not, you know, my headphones are making funny noises saying that they're about to die, so I might just switch headphones a second.
Okay.
Can still hear you. Can you hear me?
I can now, yeah.
Okay.
You know, that just made me think of something. Did that come with any sense of guilt, the fact that you felt you should be, like, initially when your daughter...
Yeah, tremendous, yeah.
You know, earlier you asked me about my therapy and you said what was the main things you got from it. One of the main things was realizing that it was not the particular events, but the whole story... on top of it, which was where most of the suffering was, like shame, guilt, humiliation, what that meant, what the implications were of that. All that story is where like 90% of the suffering was. At the actual the actual objective events that happened were actually, you know, a little bit of suffering. Do you see what I mean? And so that's what made it me think of that when you said that.
I didn't quite understand. Could you run through that again?
So certain events that happen might be painful, like somebody might betray you, or you might get rejected, or whatever, you might get abused, whatever. But then the meanings that we make of that, what that means, and the story we create is where we can get stuck in the suffering in that story. So what I realized from the therapy is like 90% of the story, sorry, I beg your pardon, 90% of the suffering was in what I was making it mean.
Yeah.
Like that shouldn't have happened. I shouldn't have let that happen. I shouldn't feel this way. I'm ashamed of doing that. You know, that's where all the suffering was, not in the actual event. Do you see what I mean?
Absolutely. Yeah, that totally resonates. But even though, so I was kind of like really into stoicism for about a year, and a big part of stoicism is that the suffering is caused by the stories that we tell ourselves, not by the actual events as they occur, which is sort of what you were just saying. But even though today I know that intellectually, I know that the suffering is being caused by the story that I'm telling myself, I can't seem to stop telling myself those stories. I don't know if you experienced that, whether did that like cure it for you when you knew?
Yeah, it did, because there's something about becoming aware of it that sort of takes away that drains the power from it. Once you're aware of something and a pattern, that largely eradicates it, or that was my experience.
Interesting.
It's while it's unconscious that it controls you and drives you and rules you.
Yeah.
But you're saying that's not the case for you?
No. So I discovered stoicism after reading Happy by Derren Brown, and I'd never thought that like a magician would be so influential in terms of my psychological happiness. But the book was really transformative for me. It's been the most important book that I've ever read, I think. And for the first year or two after I read the book, I was able to like intellectualize my, or think rational. If I was telling myself a story about an event and was getting really upset about it, I was able to see that rationally and then stop myself from having those irrational thoughts. But then that seemed to fade away after a few years. And I've reread the book 3 times subsequently, and it has less and less of an effect on me each time I read it. I'm no longer able to say to myself, Mark, there's no evidence for you to like this theory that I'm disliked at work and I'm constantly doing a bad job. Like, I can say to myself rationally, Mark, there's not a lot of evidence to suggest that those things are true. So don't tell yourself that story. But yeah, I still lie in bed awake at night for hours and hours and hours telling myself those stories, even though I know that I'm the one that's fabricating these stories and they're not necessarily representative of reality. I can't escape it anymore.
Oh. Is that because you haven't figured out where that originated, or is it just, are they just deeply ingrained and hard to throw off?
I have no idea, buddy. I really don't. Again, I'm sort of hopeful that this experience in October is going to uncover some of, or help me to understand, is it that I've not, like you just said, have I just not identified the thing, and once identified, it will start to dissolve, or no, it's really, really deeply ingrained and it will never, ever go away. I really don't know. I wish I did.
There's something relieving. Hang on, what am I trying to say here? I'm not quite sure how to put it, but when you accept your suffering, you kind of free yourself. Like, whilst you're in the tussle, like, I need to get rid of this suffering, I need to get rid of this suffering, this isn't the way it should be, I should be peaceful, there's a fight and a battle in that. And I don't know how to phrase it exactly, but you can kind of come to peace with it and kind of accept it's never going to go away. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, and again, like, I kind of know that rationally and intellectually, and I've heard enough people say that you need to just accept your suffering and accept the things that have happened in the past and accept that anxiety or pain or anger are part of my life. But knowing it intellectually is different from feeling it phenomenologically, to use another fancy unused word. I get that. It makes complete sense. And I heard a beautiful talk between Sam Harris and this Buddhist Tibetan teacher, where he was talking about changing his own relationship with pain and suffering, and one of the most instrumental things was like accepting the panic. For him, panic was the thing to be avoided. Mm. So it makes complete sense, but I just can't seem to accept. I don't want to accept the anxiety. I don't know. Maybe that's why I haven't accepted it, because I don't want to. I don't want this anxiety to be part of my life.
Yeah. I mean, with my stuff, it wasn't anxiety, so it's different, but that was part of it. Like, I went from, like, oh, I need to get rid of these feelings, these sort of painful memories and stuff. I need to get rid of this. I got to a place of, I'm never getting rid of those feelings. Never, ever. They're never going away. And I accept that. And ironically, they kind of go away. You know, it's sort of a paradox.
Yeah.
Isn't it? It takes the sting out of them. Like, they're never going. I can't change that. And I accept that. And that's actually that feels better, you know?
Yeah, interesting. So maybe for me, I'm sort of self-diagnosing now with your help, but maybe the thing that is causing this anxiety is guilt or something else. Mm. And I need to identify what that is and then accept it. And then maybe the anxiety will go. I don't know. But I often wonder like how much like the sorts of hedonism that I'm going to sound really mean now, maybe towards certain groups of people, but like if the thing that you enjoy most in life is like you go to work, finish work, have a few beers with your mates, and then you go home and stick Coronation Street on and read some trashy shit, and you seem to generally be happy. I often thought, oh, being, you know, the pseudo intellectual, I don't want that. That's a shallow form of happiness. I want a deeper form of happiness where I'm interested in smart things, not watching Coronation Street or EastEnders and reading trashy magazines. But I don't know. I have a bit of cognitive dissonance where I'm like, oh, I don't know. Like, if the thing that you actually want is to not suffer and to be happy, maybe it would have been better to be born into that world where the thing that you desire is to just go for drinks with your mates after work and then watch Coronation Street. Maybe it is better to have a simpler form of existence, a less intellectual, growth-oriented form of existence. Mm. I don't know.
Oh, yeah, I'm with you. Yeah, I relate to that, that battle between, like, you know, I look at, I'll just say, normal people. It's like, these motherfuckers, they just go out, they get drunk, they have a good time, they do fuck all, they're not, you know, they're not changing the world, and these motherfuckers are happier than me, and I'm sort of trying to strike.
It's not fair.
yeah, why can't I just be a dumb motherfucker like them?
Yeah, then I'd be happy, yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And there's something,
but maybe they're smarter than us.
there's something in that, isn't there? I don't know what the answer is, but there's some path in between. But, like, That goes back to the thing I was saying about being surrounded by people that I was not like-minded with. Like, now I feel I'm more in a place where I've got more like-minded friends, and I feel understood, and they understand me, and I feel like I've got... Whereas in the past, you know, these fucking yoga people, they were into all kinds of shit that I went into, like going on vegan retreats and going on yoga retreats to Bali and environmentalism and stuff that I just didn't care about, and I felt really I wanted to connect with them and have friends and stuff, but I couldn't connect with them because I had no interest in anything they were interested in, and I was in that constant sort of
deadlock. Why do you think you were drawn to these communities in the first place then, given that you seem to identify with being a rational capitalist?
Yeah, good question. That's something I'm still trying to figure out. I'm not sure.
Yeah, interesting. When you say that's something I'm still trying to figure out, like, are you trying to figure it out, or are you happy to not to have that piece of the puzzle missing?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know. I'm still in that process. I'm not sure.
Mm. Cool.
Well, it's been a great conversation, Mark.
Cheers. Yeah, no, I've really enjoyed it very much. It's yeah, it's been therapeutic, which is always good.
Well, that's what happens when you have good proper conversations with good proper people.
That would be a really lame but accurate title for your podcast. Good proper conversations with good proper people.
Yeah, I've enjoyed it. Well, keep me updated about everything that's going on. You know, if there's any events, yeah, we'll or do. Anything, I'll come and get involved. So, you know, keep me in the loop.
Sounds good, mate. Definitely will do.
All right, Mark. Okay, nice talking to you.
Yeah, you too, buddy. All take it easy.
Bye-bye.
Bye.